Hariom, everybody. I would like to introduce our speaker, whose discourse will be on Vivek Chudamani. This is a rather difficult and challenging subject, but our speaker, Sharda Ben, who is known lovingly as Sharda Amma, will simplify it so that we can all have a better understanding. Most of us know Sharda Amma because she has visited our center many times for Hanuman Chalisa and other programs. My wife Manju and I had opportunity to meet her many times during Mahasamadhi program. She started her mission in the 1960s during her college years. She and her mother attended Gurudev's first lecture in Mumbai and they were mesmerized. In the 1970s, she came to New York and started her first Bal Vihar class in the United States. She was blessed with a family who have wholeheartedly supported her in her mission. Initially, Bal Vihar parents were not participating, so she astutely talked to Gurudev, who provided her with intense training to begin to involve and incorporate parents. Her theory was, regards to parents is that we are responsible to provide our children with an opportunity to read, express thoughts, and freely talk about our Hindu culture. This gives children a solid foundation and simultaneously makes parents proud. In 1984, she moved to Ann Arbor, Michigan, where she started her first Bal Vihar class in her basement with only 6 children. With a collective family effort, this idea expanded exponentially. She still remains Acharya at that center. She is also musically oriented and was chanting the Bhagavad Gita in many of Gurudev's lectures. She plays many roles such as wife, mother, Acharya, teacher, president, board of directors, and many more. Without further ado, it is my honor to introduce her. Please join me in welcoming Sharda Amma. Thank you.
Hari Om. Om. Om Sahana Bhavatu, Sahanau Bhunaktu, Sahaviryam Karavavahai, Tejasvina Vadhitamastu, मा विद्विषावहैः ओम शांति शांति शांतिः समस्त जन कल्याणी निरतम करुणामयम् नमामि चिन्मयम् देवम् सद्गुरुम् ब्रह्मविद्वरम् सद्गुरुम् ब्रह्मविद्वरम् ओम शन्नो मित्र शं वरुणः शन्नो भवत्वर्यमा शन्न इन्द्रो बृहस्पतिः शन्नो विष्णुरुरुक्रमः नमो ब्रह्मणे नमस्ते वायो त्वमेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्मासि त्वमेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्म वदिष्यामि ऋतं वदिष्यामि सत्यं वदिष्यामि तन्माम् अवतु तद्वक्तारम् अवतु अवतु माम् अवतु वक्तारम् ओम शांति शांति शांतिः ओम सदाशिव समारंभम् शंकराचार्य मध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्तम् वंदे गुरु परंपराम् ओम श्रुति स्मृति पुराणानां आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पाद शंकरं लोकशंकरं शंकरं लोकशंकरं। Hari Om everyone. My namaskars to Pujya Gurudev, Pujya Guruji, Swami Shantananda Ji, Swarupananda Ji, and all Pittsburgh Chinmaya devotees, and all rest of the people who are all here. First of all, I want to thank all the organizers for this great opportunity, especially Ganesh, Vishala, Satish, Suresh, Vasanji, and all others. As you know, Vasanji very easily said that I'm going to be talking about it, you know, in a very perfect way. Actually, I don't know how I'm going to do this, because Viveka Chudamani is a vast text, 581 shlokas in 5 days marathon. So I may be only able to give an overview of the different topics, so that people will get some kind of a taste for this, and then hopefully, you know, we'll have more chances to go in details. This is almost like touching the tip of an iceberg. Since Viveka Chudamani was a favorite for our Gurudev, as we all know, it became my favorite text too, as I have heard it many times from Pujya Gurudev, and I was so fortunate that I could even chant for him in that marathon camp in 1992 for Viveka Chudamani. What a blessing it was. Now, without any further delay, let us start with the Viveka Chudamani, which starts with the Now first we'll just say what Viveka Chudamani is. In our tradition, there are two types of granthas or books. One is called as the Shastra or the scriptures. The other one is called as Prakarana Granthas. Now, book of categories, you can say. Now, what do Shastras deal with? As we know, Vedanta Shastra deal with, mainly we all know Upanishads, Bhagavad Gita, and also Brahma Sutra, etc. What about the Prakarana Granthas? The Prakarana Granthas are related to only a part of the whole scripture. And by itself, they are not actually a part of the whole scripture. It is related to a part. It is an independent work as opposed to the Upanishads, etc. It is authored by a person, an individual. Even though the source is the Upanishads, Upanishads, as we know, are divine revelations. Whereas these Prakarana Granthas are man-made. It is written. What are the topics? There are so many different topics that are dealt with in the Prakarana Granthas. To name a few, just to get an idea, the first one is Shishya Lakshanam. Shishya Lakshanam means what are the characteristics of a student. How about the teacher? Yeah, that also comes next. Yeah? So it says Guru Lakshanam, the next one. That is the characteristics of a competent teacher. Yeah. And then the third one is called as Guru Upasadana Vidhi. Means how to approach, the proper way of approaching a teacher. I can't go into the details of everything, but if Gurudev were there, he would say, you should not be, like how people come to India, it seems, on a vacation for 10 days, and then they would call Gurudev or any guru and say, come on, now I have 2 minutes before I can catch my flight back to America, so please teach me, what is this Upanishad? So it doesn't happen like that. You have a certain methodology in which you have to go by that. You have to go and then you have to approach the teacher the proper way. Then the Vishaya means the subject matter is nothing but Tattvamasi, right? So that thou art. That can be split into three. First is Tvam, thou, you. So, what does thou or you, tvam pada vichara, what does that you stand for? And then next one is tat pada vichara, what does that stand for in that tatvam asi mahavakya? That is the second, in that is the third, three things, tatvam asi. First comes tvam, then comes tat, then asi. Asi means that which is aikya vichara. Aikya vichara means how come you and that? How come they both are same? How can that be? I can't even believe that it can be the same. Yeah. So that asi pada vichara, you are, thou art, that verb is being done in the next section. Then up to this, we can listen. That is called as Shravanam. As we know, the three prong in our studies is first Shravanam, then comes Mananam, and then comes Nididhyasanam. That is first listening and then ruminating over it, trying to understand what was heard, not just let it go like from one ear to the other ear, but actually trying to understand what we have learned. Then the last one is trying to abide by that truth that has been understood by us. So that is Nididhyasanam. Right? So up to what we have done, up to Tattvamasi, up to that, it is Shravanam. We listen carefully. Then comes a question in our mind. But all this Virodha means all these contrary thoughts come to our mind because we start thinking, how can I be equal to that? That is not possible. So all those aikya vichara, that is aikya virodha vichara, means how can that be the same? I want to find out and I have to nullify all my negative thoughts. That is the next portion through mananam, through question answer, through ruminating, through asking, and then finding out, etc., happen during that time. Then comes after that, once you are convinced, it comes, the next topic that is dealt with is called as Sakshatkara Sadhanam. In other words, the means to realize this, and that's called as Nididhyasanam or meditation. So first, what is the competent student? Who is the proper student? The student's lakshanam, then the teacher's lakshanam, then how to approach a teacher, then the three, the tattvam, asi, all the three, and then how to understand what are the opposite views and how to mitigate that. That is the next one. And then finally, once you understand, to be totally established in this knowledge, that is called as Nididhyasanam. Up to that, once you get established, then the next topic is Jivan Mukta Lakshanam. Means, how does a person, the characteristics, let us say, of a person who is totally a realized one? What are the characteristics? How can we know a realized person? All these topics may not be dealt in all different Prakarana Granthas or in all the Shastras, but here we find in Viveka Chudamani, everything is beautifully told. As we go along, I'll tell you how beautifully Shankara, who is not only a poet, he is a scholar, he is a great person of realization, extremely compassionate above all. You know, that's why we say Alayam Karunalayam. You know, so he is an ocean of compassion. When you read his works, or when you even see all the commentaries that he has written, your heart goes out to this person who, for us to understand, has gone into such depths that he just never gets tired of repeating himself 1,000 times just for us to understand. So we cannot pay enough, you know, we cannot express our gratitude to Shankara, who is the greatest masters that we can ever come across. So this Shankaracharya, he is the one who introduces actually the Upanishadic mantras into the Viveka Chudamani. So as we go through Viveka Chudamani, sometimes when you read even Upanishad, you will think that Upanishads have copied from Viveka Chudamani, because it is so beautifully woven. It will look like the original is only Viveka Chudamani and Upanishads are all just copies. You will feel like that. But we know what a great poet, you know, great person was Shankaracharya. So we know Shankaracharya's greatness. Why did he give the title Viveka Chudamani? This book itself is called Viveka Chudamani. So Viveka Chudamani means crest jewel. What is crest jewel? You know, in the picture that, you know, Pittsburgh people have put, they have put two crowns, but it's not a crown. No, Chudamani is not a crown, but Chudamani is the jewel that is worn on top of the head like this. I don't know if you have seen that. It is a beautiful ornament. That's what was given to Hanumanji as a chinnam, as a insignia of you know, Sita Devi, when she gives back, when Hanuman gives the ring of Rama to Sita, then he asks for some kind of a sign to take back, and then Sita Devi takes out from her hair this Chudamani, which she is wearing, to take back to for Rama, you know, to know that he had seen her. We all know that. So that is a Chudamani, which is worn right on top of the head. That means it has the highest position amongst all other ornaments. Yeah? So if that is the highest of ornaments, highest in what here? It says Viveka. Viveka means discrimination. Unfortunately, this word discrimination, we don't even understand because of all its color, you know, its coloration, because of, you know, we think that it is racial discrimination, color discrimination, etc. That's not what we are talking about. This is about the intellect. Okay, so this is talking about the discrimination, which is the faculty of intellect. Now, we human beings, at least hope, that we are all endowed with this intellect, which is the seat of discrimination, with which we can discriminate between the right from the wrong. Ayo, that is not a great thing. You may think like that. It is easier to separate grosser things. If there are certain colored in the schools, you know, in the young children's classes, they are given some colored marbles and they are asked to separate, okay, you know, separate green from blue or green, or all those things are easy to do. Yeah. And then next comes, so many people don't even know whether to eat this or not, whether to eat this or eat that. What kind of food should we eat? Should I be a vegetarian or not? Discrimination is needed. Okay, that is not difficult. Okay, should I cross the road now or should I not cross the road now? Little bit difficult. That's also possible. But when it comes to our duties and our responsibilities, we don't know as to what should be done. Yeah, it becomes more and more difficult because it is not perceptual. Yeah. So when it becomes subtler, then the discrimination becomes more and more difficult. So what is moral? What is immoral? What is legal? What is illegal? What is righteous and what is unrighteous? What are the right things to do? What are the unrighteous things to do? It becomes more and more serious as we go subtler to the subtler subjects. Now, the most serious of all these kind of dilemmas is that I don't know myself. What? Yeah, none of us knows who we really are. So the most serious question is, who am I? What am I thinking of myself as? What is it? What is actually me and what is not me? When you come to this kind of a question, then it is mind-boggling. We don't know the answer for this. So the book which separates, which tells you actually to separate the self from the not self. From the self to the not self. To know what is self and what is not self and how to separate them is called as the, it has to be given the name as the crest jewel. Actually, Shankara himself is the Chudamani. The Viveka Chudamani is Shankara, because if you take the Jivan Mukta, who we just now said, what are the Lakshanas of a Jivan Mukta Purusha, you can see Shankara and he is the Jivan Mukta Purusha. Okay, so he is an example of that. Then we say, what is the Guru's Lakshanam? Who is a competent teacher? He said that. Again, Shankara is the most competent teacher that we can know of. Everything you take, the superlative, the positive is only Shankara. So when we say Viveka Chudamani, who should we be thinking of? Only that great Shankaracharya, who stands as a beacon for all of us. Now, having said this, Shankara, we have to just remember a little more of Shankaracharya. When he came into this world, the whole of India actually was, the culturally very, very degraded. So in the fourth chapter of Bhagavad Gita, the Lord says, as the time goes on, the dharma goes down, goes away, and then more and more adharma starts, becoming prominent in the world. Something like that was happening at that time. So people, in the name of being very religious, they started becoming more and more ritualistic without understanding what rituals are. And then to such a low extent that they even started doing animal sacrifices. Yeah. So at that time, Buddha came and he started propagating the, non-violence, etc. So people started becoming more and more Buddhistic and not believing in Vedas properly. So it was needed, a person like Shankara had to come to revive our Hinduism from whatever it was going through at that time. Perfect timing. So as we all know, he was born like a genius, we all know. At the age of 5, it seems he wrote a grammar, Sanskritam grammar book. Sanskritam grammar. You and I can't even pronounce properly the words. And here is a 5 or 6 year old child who wrote a book on Sanskritam grammar. What can we talk of this child? he had lost his father when he was very young. And then at the age of 7 or 8, it seems, I mean, they say that he had gone to see a drama in the local temple and had seen Nachiketa's story in Kathopanishad. That made him understand that life was not what we are looking at, but it is something more. And I need to know, like Nachiketa, how he went to Yama to get the answers. I want to go to my teacher to get these answers. So at the age of 7 or 8, he goes and asks his mother to let him go to become a sannyasi. Which mother would leave a child like that at that age? So she said, no, no, no. So he waited for the right time. And as the story goes, we all know, he went to take a bath in the river one day. The mother was standing on the banks of the river. And then a crocodile came and caught hold of his feet. And then he could not pull. As we know, in the water, crocodile is very, 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 very strong. We had talked about it last month only from Panchadashi. So how the crocodile holds on. And he shouted to his mother, 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 please let me become a sannyasi. Give me the permission so I can become a sannyasi before I die. So the mother was so, so much overwhelmed. She says, yeah, yeah, I give you permission. So he shouted 3 times, I'm a sannyasi, I'm a sannyasi. And then it looked like the Lord had come in the form of the crocodile. And at that time, the crocodile left him. And so he was okay. He came up and did namaskar. And he said, okay, mom, I'm going. And the mother said, hey, where are you going? He said, you already gave me the permission. So she had to take a promise from him that he would come back when she needs him. And then he leaves, goes to Govindapada. And then the rest is all history. We all know what happened. So such a great scholar. He was not only, we can see when he wrote all the commentaries, etc., he has to not give his own opinion. He has to totally adhere to whatever has been written. He cannot go one word here or there. He has to be extremely careful that he doesn't cross the line. So you can imagine the poetry in him must have just welled up that he wanted to write something where he could totally give all the expressions in something. And there came Viveka Chudamani. As you go through it, you understand that it is not just Sanskritam that is flowing, but looks like Goddess Saraswati herself is flowing through the words. The poetry is just exquisite. The words are just beautiful. They touch your heart. And as you sing it, you just go into samadhi yourself. So this is not an exaggeration. As we go along, we'll see how beautiful the shlokas are. Okay, so with this much of introduction to the text, let us now start with the text itself, because we have to remember the time limit. Yeah, so it's kind of hard for me as to what to choose. It is beautifully, Shankara has written this whole Viveka Chudamani in the form as though like a drama. Yeah, what is a drama? One student first understands as to what the preciousness of this, how precious this life is, and how we all just, you know, spend it away without understanding as to the great value of our life is not known to us. And once it is known to us, what should one do? How one should develop a proper qualities on our own? And once we develop the proper qualities, then he approaches a teacher and then he asks the question. Each one is a beauty by itself. I don't want to give out too much of the all the beautiful things that are coming up. So let us first see the first Mangala Shlokam. Traditionally, that's how all the texts start, with the namaskar or prostrations to either God or Guru. So both are same anyway. So now coming to the first shloka, I hope you all have the book with you. If you don't have, then you can, you know, download it from, there are so many websites, please keep them ready. So as we go along, you may be able to follow it. You can even chant with me. If you want, I can wait for a little bit so you can repeat after me so that you will also know how to chant. Because each shloka suddenly will be different meters. Great challenge it was when we were doing the videotaping of this, because all the people around you should also be singing properly. Otherwise, you cannot change the tune suddenly. It was a real, real challenge for me. I know how beautiful it is. So now going to the first Mangala Shlokam. Let us chant. Sarva Vedanta Siddhanta Gocharam Tamagocharam Govindam Paramanandam Sadgurum Pranatosmyaham. Let us chant together. Sarva Vedanta Siddhanta Gocharam Tamagocharam Govindam Paramanandam Sadgurum Pranatosmyaham. So, Pranatosmi Aham. I bow down to, I do namaskar to. Pranatosmi Aham. Who do I do namaskar to? I do namaskar to the Satguru. Who is a Satguru? The Sat stands for reality, as we all know. So that teacher who reveals the nature of that supreme reality to us, he is called as a Sadguru. Now, the jiva, we are all jivas, has wandered away as though from that Lord Shiva. The jiva and Shiva have now separated. Supposing a child walks away, a baby walks away, not baby, but a child walks away from the home and doesn't know where he's going, he just sees Lord. How will the people in the house feel? They'll all be devastated. And suddenly, some person finds the child and brings back the child to the house and says, I found this child. Does he belong here? How will the mother feel? What will the mother feel about that person who has united her with that child? This is what, you know, the guru does to a shishya. The jiva has wandered away. We don't know since how many births we have wandered away. Wandering, not finding our own true nature. We have finally come to this birth. Let us feel that we are in the last birth. Otherwise, we cannot even want to listen to Vivek Chudamani. The very reason that we are here shows that we are really ready for the final takeoff. Okay, we'll talk about it later as we go along. Okay, so I'm not trying to make you all feel very good. This is the truth. If we are up, we have come up to here, we are now ready. So the teacher is the one who is going to unite the jiva and the Lord and the Paramatma. And then what can we have? Only Paramanandam. Paramanandam stands for the Parabrahma only, the Brahman only. Okay, so here we say, Pranatosmi Aham. I do namaskar to Satguru, the teacher who is going to unite me with that Sat, that reality that I am. Now, and here there is a pun on the word Govindam. Govindam, Govinda Bhagavad Pada was Shankaracharya's guru. We all know that. But we also know from Bhajagovindam, there are so many meanings to this word, Govinda. So now Govinda Bhagavat Pada, is the guru, but Govinda also stands for the Lord, for Lord Krishna, for Govinda. There is, from this we know, guru and God, Ishwaro Guru Ratmeti Murti Bheda Vibhagine. So that Ishwara and the guru are one and the same is told through us in this, through this to us. Okay. So also there is one more meaning for this Go. Go means Upanishads, Vedas. Okay. So Go Vinda. Vinda means to attain. Okay. So that which is attained through this Upanishads, through the study of the Upanishads, is called, that reality is called as Govinda. Okay, so many meanings in this beautiful verse itself. I don't know what all we can go through, but the first Mangalacharanam, this is called as the first shloka itself, according to all these shastras, you have to understand that it should reveal the Anubandha Chatushtayam. So who is the, what is the Vishaya, what is the, all these, there are four different things. When we get a chance, we'll just go through all that. Everything is contained in this beautiful verse. Okay, so now who is this Govinda? Govinda is that Paramananda. Paramananda means is of the nature of absolute bliss. Supreme bliss is called as Paramananda. So when we say Guru Sakshat Parabrahma, that means Guru is nothing but that Brahman itself, which is of the nature of Parama Ananda. So many people say, why do you have to make such a big fuss about Gurus? After all, Guru is a Guru. He is just teaching, that's all. Don't have to think of him as the ultimate reality. There is a flaw in this thought. Why? Because what is this Guru going to teach you? This Guru is going to teach you that you are Brahman. Yeah. So what am I going to get as a result? The result is that I'm going to know that I am that Brahman. I am Brahman and my teacher is not Brahman. How does that work? If the teacher is the one who is taking me to the ultimate reality, he is already there. He is that reality. Okay. So this is a beautiful, beautiful shloka. Within these two lines, Shankara is bringing all the Vedantic texts, thoughts into this. So here it says, Sarva Vedanta Siddhanta Gocharam, that ultimate reality, which is revealed as the principle of all the Vedantic texts. All the Vedantas, Vedantic texts, talk about this particular reality. So that principle which is revealed through all the Vedanta, that is only through that you can gocharam. Gocharam means that which can be attained through only this. But otherwise agocharam. What beautiful, no? Gocharam tam agocharam. That which is attained through that, but otherwise it is not possible to attain it. Why not? Because it is not perceptible through any direct means or indirect means, inference also. You cannot know this. So it is only through Shabda Pramanam or through the words of the Vedantic text that we can get this. So Sarva Vedanta Siddhanta Gocharam, which is realized, which is as the principle of all the Vedantic texts, but otherwise agocharam, like all direct perceptions, etc., or inference, etc., fail. Through eyes you cannot see, through nose you cannot smell, all those things. You cannot have a perception of this. So the highest level of prostration, when I do namaskar, that means I am realizing. Okay, so I have now understood my Ishwara, my Guru and my Ishwara are one and the same. I do namaskar to that. So, Sarva Vedanta Siddhanta Gocharam Tam Agocharam. I hope you are all understanding. Govindam, that Lord. Paramanandam, who is the teacher as well as the ultimate reality. that teacher, Sat Gurum, because he is the one who is revealing my ultimate nature to me. So he is the Sat Guru. Pranatosmi. Pranatosmi. When I say Nata, means I am doing namaskar. When will one do namaskar? You know, a person who is very, very egotistical, the head won't even come down. So say the stiff head, you know, they won't even bow down. When you bow down, you are accepting that somebody is higher than you, right? So pranatosmi shows that the person is endowed with all the qualities that are necessary for a proper shishya. So all this stands for all the various things that are supposed to be in the first loka itself. All the anubandha chatushtayam is beautifully brought out in this very simple looking shloka. So let us all read it together. I hope you all got all the words meaning. Sarva Vedanta Siddhanta Gocharam Tama Gocharam Govindam Paramanandam Sadgurum Pranatosmyaham. All right. Now, Shankara, in the next shlokas, is telling us how glorious is this spiritual life. So now you can see, that was one tune that we now chanted. Suddenly now it has become a huge, big, all his poetry is flowing out. Suddenly he will just break out into, you know, happiness. Like we say, suddenly somebody starts dancing when they are very happy. That's what you feel like doing when you read this shloka. All right. So this is one of those difficult four-lined ones. So let us now chant the next one, showing the glory of the spiritual life. Jantunam narajanma durlabhamataha. Punsvam tato viprata. Tasmat vaidika dharma marga parata. Vidvatvam asmat param. Atmanatma vivechanam svanubhava. Brahmatmana samsthitihi muktirno shata janma koti sukrutaihi punyair vina labhyate together. Jantunam narajanma durlabha matah pumstvam tato viprata tasmat vaidika dharma marga parata vidvatvam asmat param atmanatma vivechanam svanubhavo brahmatmana samsthitihi muk Tirno shata janma koti sukrutaihi punya irvina labhyate. So, Darwin has only told us the evolution from unicellular organism to human being. We have come up to that. That is, science can only go up to that. Whereas Shankara takes us to the next step of how from humanhood you can become divine. So the leap is from becoming from ordinary human to, you know, the leap is so high to that divine, divinity itself. So how to do that can be had. Only, you know, only this beautifully, it now, you know, how this has come through, Shankara is saying. So, jantunam narajanma durlabham. We can all understand, it's very easy. Narajanmam is very, that is, being born as a human being. As a human, to be born as a human is very, very durlabha. Means dukhena labhyate, that which is very, very rare or very, very precious. Jantunam, amongst all creatures. What are you talking about? The population growth. Don't you know? There are just so many people in India and China. You just go and see. Probably you don't know. That's why you're talking like that. That's what we all think. As you know, scientists, we all have facts and figures. But do we know how many insects are there? Do we know how many worms, germs, plants, trees, blades of grass? Go to the marine world. How many sea animals, how many fish, how many birds, how many kinds of different things? If you take the percentage of human beings, we don't know how people can do it, but they have come up with one number. If you want to take it, take it. Otherwise, just take it. You can just laugh about it. 0.02%, it seems. Okay, we don't know how they came up with that. So 0.02% is the human beings when you compare with all the jantus, all the jivarashis, all the different living beings. If we take that, how difficult is it to get this human birth? We just think that, oh, after all, so many people are there, so many people are born, so many people get killed. It is not that easy to get this beautiful human birth. That is the first thing. And coming to the next word, ataha, and then pumstvam. This word is not understood by people and they immediately start jumping up and down. This is what I don't like about all these. So pumstvam doesn't stand for being born as a man, but having manliness. Abstract noun. Yeah, puman and pumstvam means that manliness. In other words, to have humane qualities. We may be born as human beings, but without humane qualities, we cannot be called as human beings. Neither the animals will accept us, nor the human beings will accept us. We are nowhere. So to have that courage of conviction, to the ability to achieve something, you know, to have the goal and then achieve it, that is called as pumstvam. How many of us will have that? Already human beings are so low. And from that, how many people have that manliness? You know, there may be people who have the man's body, but totally cowards. Yeah. There could be women with that kind of great qualities. We have had in our history, you know, Sita ji, we have had Rukmini. You all know when you read all the stories, there are so many great people. Shabari, you can just name it. There are Jhansi Ki Rani in so many places. You just see when you read Devi Mahatmyam, you know how many goddesses are there. So all these, when you think of that person who has that kind of ability to achieve something, that drive, pumstvam, and then the next one, tataha, greater than that, is viprata. Vipra means normally you take it as a brahmana, but actually viprata, it stands for one who studies all the scriptures. The person who studies the scriptures, how many people are there? So first of all, human, to be born as a human being with the humane qualities, then to study the scriptures. So now three have come. Next one, tasmat Vaidika Dharma Marga Parata. To pursue the life as it is advised in the Vedas, in all the scriptures. One thing is, there are so many philosophy teachers, so many philosophy professors, they can quote left and right. You know, for anything, when you argue, they will have quotations from different scriptures. But are you living it? No, no, no. That is not for living. It is only for giving lectures and getting some money. So that is not what we are talking about. We are talking about people who have the courage of conviction and they follow what they have learnt. That is rarer still. So the percentage wise, it is becoming lesser and lesser and lesser. Tasmat Vaidika Dharma Marga Parata. Okay. Then Vidvatvam Asmat Param. More than that, Vidvatvam. A Vidvan is an intellectual, a person who is intelligent. Yeah? So we may have all these things, but intelligence is not there, not smart enough to remember things, to grasp things. What can you do? Yeah. So in order to know dharma from adharma, what is right, what is wrong, so that one is only when the dilemmas arise. No, there are so many crossroads, as we say, in our lives. What to do this or to do that? That kind of a question when it comes, can you take a proper decision? Yeah. So that kind of a viprata, vidvatvam, sorry. Vidvatvam is vidvan, to be intelligent. Okay, still great. Then comes to the next point. Atma anatma vicharam. So vivechanam means vichara. So what is self, what is not self, what is me, what is not me, yeah? To know that, oh my god, that is so difficult. That's why we have come to your class. So you may say like that, so we have come up to atma anatma vivechanam. Remember, you are all up to here. Yeah, so don't think that we are all ordinary people. We are all up to this Atma Anatma Vivechanam. That is what we are going to be doing for the 5 days. Okay, Atma Anatma Vivechanam. That is okay. After that, once I know who, what is Atma, then the experience. So, Sva Anubhava, Su Anubhava, the clear experience of the self in one own bosom. Yeah? That is even still difficult to have your own experience, having your own experience, then what, there won't be any questions at all because you have already experienced. Yeah. So Swanubhava, and after experiencing, because we get a glimpse here and there, as we go along, you will also feel, today I think now I caught it, I got that. We will all feel like that. Oh, really? Yes, really. So then, having gotten that, what should be the next step? The last steps in this is Brahmatmana Samsthitihi. Means total firm abidance in this, in this experience. Firm abidance. Yeah? To get that is so difficult. And it says, Brahmatmana Samsthitihi. Once you get that realization, that is called as mukti. Then that is called as the liberation. So that, he says, Shata Janma Koti Sukrutaihi Punyaihi Vina No Labhyate. It cannot be gotten without the merits of Shata Janma Koti Janma. Shata Janma, Shata means tens of crores, Shata means hundred, hundreds of crores of life. 1 crore is 10 million. Yeah? So you can just calculate. So many Janmas, we have done some Punyam to come up to where we are. So it is extremely rare to be born as human with humane qualities, to have some, the manliness, to have the courage of conviction, to study the scriptures, and then to live that way of life, and then to have that vidvatvam, dharma, dharma, what is right, what is wrong, the moral, you know, immoral, what is that, and then atma, anatma, vivechanam, discrimination between what is atma, what is anatma, and then the experience of I am, that experience, and then to be abiding in that. Okay, now we have understood. Thank you very much. We are not coming back to the class anymore. Hey, we are actually there. Don't be frightened when you hear this, because we all have this human birth, and we all are exposed to this. From you are all in different study groups, I know. So Tattva Bodha 2, Atma Bodha 2, wherever you are, all these things slowly and slowly, we are all acquiring all these qualifications. So we are trying to follow, we are all studying, we are all trying to follow, and then we are now in the stage, in this Vivek Chudamani, Atma Anatma Vivechanam. As we keep doing, the fruits of it you will definitely feel. As and when we go, you will get Svanubhava also. As we get that happiness, without anything, that is called a Svanubhava. So that also is there, and all that has come only because of all the punyas that we must have done in our previous birth, and then all that we need just now is one little push. Like Nachiketa, Yamaraja says that you are at the gates of realization. All that you need is, I'll just push you and you will be in. The same thing here, Brahmatmana Samsthitihi, the abiding nature in that Brahman is what we are needing, we are going to have, and that we can get as we become more and more adept in doing our Nididhyasanam, our meditation. So only last step is there for us. All the others, we are all already here. Just because you have registered and you have come to this lecture, already all those prerequisites, all these things are already taken care of. So doesn't that feel good? Definitely it should feel good. Okay, so we need a little push during these 4-5 days. We'll try to give you the right push and we can really reach there after this. Having said that, Shankara is saying three things are very difficult to get. The same thing is told in a little bit different way. Let us just see it quickly. In the third shloka, Durlabham Trayame Vaitat Devanugraha Hetukam Manushyatvam Mumukshutvam Mahapurusha Samshrayaha. Together, Durlabham Trayame Vaitat Devanugraha Hetukam Manushyatvam Mumukshutvam Mahapurusha Samshrayaha. So these three things are extremely difficult, it says. What are they? Durlabham Trayam Etat. What are the three? It says, it is only by Lord's grace and your effort we can get this. One is Manushyatvam. We know the human form. Very, very difficult to get. Mumukshutvam. And in that, to strive to become liberated. So I asked once Gurudev, I don't have that mumukshutvam, no burning desire to get realized. What is this? What can I do? He said, no, just the fact that you are attending shows that you have the mumukshutvam. So which was a great thing for me. And for all of us to get into that, protection of that, of our Gurudev, who has given us all this at our fingertips. Being in America, we don't even feel like we have left India at all. There is more India here than India itself, because we are so lucky in so many ways that Gurudev has come to our own places and has tried to lift us. What more can we ask for? So it says that these Mahapurusha Samshrayaha, for us to have his grace, Gurudev's grace, is a great, great blessing. So let us not undermine that. Whatever, wherever we have come, it's all because of his grace. Having understood this, we have to know that this is not the life that we should not be leading, ordinary life. Having come up to this, we should understand that we are now, all of us who are all here, we are all destined for the highest moksha. This brings me to one story. You might have heard this. There were some squirrels. These squirrels used to be happily playing in a garden, in some forest kind of thing. People used to be coming there for excursions, and they would just feed them with some nuts. So one guy really wanted to catch one squirrel. So he brought some nuts and slowly, you know, put it in front of a squirrel, and then he had it in his hand. The poor squirrel thought that he could just get it. He just came and he took it, and then that guy caught him, put him in a bag and took him home. And then he did not do anything, but he just tied a rope and then tied that rope, the end of the rope to a brick. So the poor thing, you know, it could not go anywhere but that radius of the rope. It would just be going around. It was left in the yard, and he would go to work, but he would feed it in the morning and in the evening. That was not a problem. There was a dog next door. It could see through the gate. There was a wooden gate that it was all holy. Holy means a lot of holes. And it would just keep on barking. And then this guy would get very scared. But this went on. One day it became summer, and all the other squirrels were going about in the on the trees, and this squirrel was looking, and it was remembering its freedom. So he was so happy. Oh, when will I have that? When will I have that? He kept on thinking. All the other squirrels felt sorry for him, and they started nibbling on his rope to free him. At that time, that bark, the barking, ferocious dog, he was very big. He just pushed open the gate and he entered. At that time, the rope snapped because these other squirrels were, biting on that. And then this just ran and went up the tree, and it was saved. From then on, it was very free. It was very happy, going about very, very happily. But once in a way, he would remember that master and how he used to give food. Winter came, there was no food. At that time, the squirrel was sitting alone and thinking, if I had been with the master, it would have been better, because he would have given me food. There was a wise squirrel who came around and said, Buddhu, don't think like that, because that was bondage. The bondage is something you want to get rid of. When you don't have it, then only you know. Don't go back to that life. Don't think that was good. This is what we need a guru for. We don't even know that we are in bondage. The guru only comes and tells us, this is not the life to lead. You should get mukti. So we are all so grateful for this Viveka Chudamani, for our Gurudev's explanations, for Shankaracharya for giving this, and for our organizers for organizing this. There are so many things that can go wrong, but if everything has come, or I know everything has become right, and here we are very, very thankful. Okay, with that we'll stop today, and then I will take topic by topic. So the greatness of human life is what was told today, and how how this evolution can take place only in this. The realization of the self alone should be sought after. For that, what should we do? We'll see tomorrow. And the questions that that a student should ask a teacher, you cannot ask better questions. So we'll do that tomorrow. And then slowly and slowly, we'll go to the next step. And as you all know, the pinnacle of this whole thing is the meditative verses, which are so very famous. And so we'll be taking that, eventually in a couple of days. And then you will all start humming it all the time in your life. You will never forget it. Okay. With that, we'll stop now. I will say Purnamada, and then we'll do the question answers. And then, that will be the end. Okay. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेव वशिष्यते ओम शांति 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 हरि ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरि ओम ऑल राइट फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन देयर आर टू क्वेश्चंस At each instance in our lives, we have to make decisions. Oftentimes, we think we are making the right decisions, but there is always an inherent bias bias because we like ourselves more than anything. So many times we make decisions, but it may not be, you know, right. So she says, how can I check myself to see if my decision is dharmic or selfish? Yeah. So in Taittiriya Upanishad, you all must have heard the, you know, the convocation address given by the guru to the students when they are leaving the ashram. He says the same thing, you know, whenever there is a doubt as to what is right and what is wrong, you know, dharmic, there are some very, you know, ticklish kind of dilemmas. We have to take a decision. Then what should we do? And I hope that it is not selfishness. That's what we are all trying to say, you know. So one thing I would say is that when the mind is very, very agitated, the best thing is to sit silently in meditation for a couple of minutes. Then the mind becomes a little bit clear. And then when we take up the question, the answer comes automatically. Otherwise, even if that is not satisfying, we are kind of worried whether this is the right one or not, then go to this Taittiriya Upanishad advice. He says, whenever you are in a dilemma, you go to a person who is unselfish, a person who you know has been following all the dharmic ways of living, and he is not thinking about himself. There is no selfishness, and you ask him for an answer. He will always give you, that will be the right answer. You can follow his advice and you can do that, or you just watch that person. How is he behaving under pressure like this? And then you try to follow that. So that's all we can say, that we are so lucky that we have our gurus, our swamis, our, you know, great people. We can always ask them, or we can see what they are doing and then follow that. And I'm sure when you are doing your meditation and you come to this question, then automatically I find that the answer comes to us as we are sitting. It may not come immediately. The best thing, as they say, is sleep over that. You know, when you sleep over that question, then in the morning, suddenly like Eureka, you know, and then you just, you know, get out and then you say, there I got the answer to this. So I'm sure, you know, that will help you. Okay. I hope that answer satisfies you. Otherwise, you try that, and then we'll add some more things if we want next time. Okay. The next question. There are only two questions, so this today may not be too many, you know, things. Are there any new questions now? No, nothing. No. So we'll just take up this. What is there in chat? I didn't even see. You can see if there is any question, you can tell me. So the next question, as Adi Shankaracharya tells us how important it is for the true seeker to have a guru, what does this mean for us? Do we need to stop our grihastha activities and seek a guru? Yeah. So we were going to do this in our, you know, in the Vivek Chudamani, later on it will come. You know, Gurudev always used to say, you cannot go guru hunting. The guru has to find you. Then what about, you know, Adi Shankara, he went, you know, looking for his guru and all that. But no, when the call comes, you know that it happens. All that we can do is we have to do our best and become an adhikari, means a fit student. We'll say what are the qualifications for becoming a fit student. All the four qualifications, Viveka, Vairagya, Shamadhi, Shatka Sampatti, and then Mumukshutvam. All these, when we start having the proper qualification, we'll do all this in the coming days, when we prepare ourselves to become fit for this knowledge, then automatically you will find that you will be exposed to this, that suddenly some Chinmaya mission will start in your area. You know, it was not even there. Nobody was talking about it. And then suddenly, you know, there are so many people who come and tell me, you know, Amma, if only we had Chinmaya mission or Swami Chinmayananda when we were growing up, it would have been so nice. I would have learnt. But that's not true. Everybody was there, but we are not ready for it. When we are not ready, we don't even know that the answer is right there. No, it just happens like that. But to be on a funny note, I want to tell you about this. We say that the teacher comes to you when you are ready for it. And it actually happened to one of our friends. We had this friend called Ram Kripalani, who is no more, unfortunately. So he was the first Chinmaya Mission president in New York. So what happened is, he never believed in all these gurus and all that. His sisters lived in Bombay, and they were Swami, that is Gurudev's, they were Shishyas. So when Gurudev said that he was coming to New York on a trip first time, so then those sisters were so sweet. They wrote to Ram, their brother, and said, no, Swami Chinmayananda is coming to New York for the first time. Please go and, pick him up from the airport and take him to your apartment. This guy had never heard of any Swamis and nothing. So he said, these Swamis will come there. I have nothing to do with it. He never went to the airport. This actually happened. Okay. And then Gurudev comes, nobody there at the airport. He took a taxi by himself. And then he came all the way to upstate New York. And then he found this co-op city wherein there are all the houses look, all the buildings, high rises, they all look similar. He has to find which number building, and then he has to go to the elevator. He was living on the 14th floor or something. I don't remember. So he had to take the elevator, and then he comes and then he rings the bell. And this guy is in his shorts. He looks through that hole, little eye. And then he looks, Swami! So he has never seen any Swami. He just didn't know whether to clean the apartment before opening or to dress up properly before opening. Anyway, he just pushed everything and then he opened the door. And actually, he became the guru, and he became total dedicated, and totally his life was, for Chinmaya Mission only from then on. So what I mean to say is, it is not an exaggeration to even think that when you are ready, the guru actually comes ringing your bell. No, that doesn't happen to all of us. But this really, when the time comes, when we are ready, it just happens. We all think that it was a fluke or it was just an accident. It is not an accident. It actually is all Daiva Anugraham, by God's grace. When you are ready, all that we have to do is we have to become ready. We have to be true to ourselves, and we have to follow the righteous path, etc. Even though he was not into Swamis, he was a great person of great morals. Everything was fantastic about him. So he was ready, and then Gurudev just came. So Gurudev used to say, the flowers will just have to open up. The bees will automatically come. It is the duty of the bee to come and pollinate. So if there is a lonely flower on top of a mountain where there is nothing else, then Gurudev used to say that Mahalakshmi is always, doing the massage for Lord Vishnu, and Vishnu will suddenly say, I have to go. So then Lakshmi says, go where? To be. So then this was his joke. To be what? To be bee. So that means he has to become a bee. So then he will immediately, he will buzz off to go and pollinate that one flower that is on top of the mountain, it seems. So he says that when we are ready, the guru will come to us. So we don't have to, leave the grahasthashram and leave and go and or anything like that. You be a grahastha, be a good grahastha, lead a right life, and then it automatically will happen. So wishing you all the best. I think we have come to 8:45 almost. Yeah. whenever you have any questions, you can send it and we'll try to answer. Not that I have the answer for everything, but we can try, and then whatever, you know, some of the points you can take, whatever. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ma. Thank you so much. I will send more questions as soon as I receive early in the morning.
Yeah.
Thank you, Sardabhan.
Thank you, Sardabhan.
Hari Om. Oh, nice to see you all. Thank you very much.
Hari Om, everyone.
Nice. Wonderful to see you all. Long time I have not seen Jagdish ji. I have not seen so many of you. Wonderful. Nice to see. Hope everybody is doing well.
Hari Om, everyone. I just posted the link for the questions in the chat box. So please feel free to use that if you have any questions for Sharda Ma.
Okay. Okay.
Shardama, I was there in 1992 when you were in Washington, D.C. with Gurudev.
Right. The last.
Yeah. I was very new to the country and I went for that thing.
Huh.
Yeah.
Wonderful. So nice.
Thank you. Everything, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you, Chinmaya Pittsburgh, for hosting this.
All right. Bye. Hari Om.
Hari Om.
Hari Om, everybody.
Hari Om. Hari Om.